Hello, it's Sam back with another iOS 10 screencast. This screencast is slightly different because I'm going to concentrate on the syntax changes in Swift 3. That's not everything that's changed in Swift 3. In fact, I've got three more screencasts prepared to cover the other changes. But this is going to be a really quick rundown of the stuff that you're going to need to change in your Swift code to go from Swift 2.2 up to Swift 3 in 3 minutes. That's not very long to cover the many, many changes that have gone through the Swift evolution process to form part of Swift 3. I've got five little chunks of Swift 2.2 code, and I'm going to go through each of them and decide what needs to change to turn this Swift 2 into Swift 3. I'm up for a bit of a challenge, so let's start the clock. The first sample of code shows a few things, but there's something really important you need to understand about closures before we go into it. And that is that a closure, when it's passed as an argument to a function, is either escaping or non-escaping. What does that mean? It determines whether or not that closure will be used outside of the scope of the function call that it's used in. Back in Swift 2, the default was for closures to be escaping, but now that's switched to non-escaping. I.e., by default, you can't use a closure passed in as an argument to a function outside of the scope of that function. There are four things to watch out for in example one. First up is that the plus plus and minus minus operators have been removed. So we're going to replace that with plus equals one. Next up, whenever you create a function type signature, you must use the parentheses. The no escape annotation is now part of the type itself, and in actual fact, the default for closures is now to be no escaping, which means that you need to specify when a closure is escaping. Okay, so far so good. Next up, a few things that have been removed from Swift 3, including currying syntactic sugar and C-style for loops. First thing to note is the fact that the first parameter name now behaves in exactly the same way as the other parameter names. That means that if at your call site you don't want to have to specify that first parameter, you need to add an underscore in right at the beginning. Next, this slightly quirky currying syntax has been removed. It doesn't mean you can't do currying anymore. If you want to, you just have to be explicit. So here, the add function is going to return a closure. I'm going to update the function body to represent that. It's going to return a closure, which takes a value of B in. And then the other thing that's also been removed from Swift is this C style for loop. You can no longer do var I is less than B, I++. Instead, you can use a for loop to loop through a range. Here, I don't care about the value, so I'm using the underscore. Notice again, I'm using plus equals because the plus plus operator is gone. The next example includes quite a few changes of names of things within the Swift standard library. For example, sequence type has now been renamed sequence, and generator is now an iterator. In addition to this, the really important thing is that constraints on a generic function type now appear at the end of the function signature, which once you've seen it, you'll wonder why it wasn't like this all along. This is a function that will return a set of the common elements in two sequences. In order to make this work, we've made it generic over the two different sequence types. There's a few things to fix here. First up, sequence type has been renamed sequence. Generator has been renamed iterator. And finally, there's still errors going on here, and that's because this where clause, which determines the fact that elements have to be hashable and the elements in the two sequences have to be of the same type, it used to be inside the angle brackets, which was incredibly confusing. That now goes at a much more sensible place right at the end of that function signature. The other thing to change here as part of foundation is that the intersect method on a set has been renamed intersection. Because it returns an object, it has to be named as a noun. Swift 3 introduces two new access specifiers, open and file private. In addition to this, example 4 looks at how you can remove some of the stringly typed code that you've had to write to interact with Objective-C. So you notice that inside the sources of this example, we've got a class called car, which subclasses NSObject. It was previously specified as public. You can now only subclass public classes within the same module. There is a new type called open, which allows you to subclass something outside of that module. The private access specifier restricts access to that scope, i.e. here within the class definition itself. I can't access it from with an extension. To do that, use the file private. specifier. In the past, you always had to specify key paths as strings, but now there is a key path helper. You access it using hash key path, and within there it takes a type checked value. So here, taxi.numberofpassengers will refer to exactly the same key path as before. Also a foundation thing there, the cases of enums are now lowercase. This observe value for key path method signatures changed quite a lot, so I'm just going to rewrite it. I'm going to do exactly the same code that we had before. So I'm going to perform selector on the main thread. First up, this selector thing. Now this was actually changed in Swift 2.2, but there is, in the same way that you can use the hash key path, there is also a hash selector. This again, rather than being stringly typed, is now type checked for you. The other thing is that perform selector on main thread has been renamed with on main thread going inside to be the name of the first argument. And then down here at the bottom, dynamic type property has been renamed this type of operator. NS bundle is now bundle, and the function I'm looking for here is bundle for type of taxi. The final example concentrates on enums. Updates to the naming conventions now dictate that cases of enums should be lower camel case, and that when you refer to those cases within the enum type itself, you must use the preceding dot. In addition to that, there's some nice new pattern matching syntax. Although not part of the Swift 3 syntax change, the naming guidelines suggest that cases on enums should be lower camel case. And now when you refer to those cases within the enum definition, so here on this delay property, you must use the leading dot. Jumping down to this calculate compensation method, which takes one of these enums, something you weren't able to do before but you can do now is combine these case statements, the delayed, duration, and true, and cancelled, true, and duration. You're specifying the value of duration using two different cases there. That wasn't possible in Swift 2, it's now possible in Swift 3, provided the patterns match and that the type is the same. And stop the clock. Oh well, slightly over 3 minutes, but you know, I tried. There's quite a lot to cover. By no means have I covered all of the new stuff in Swift 3. In fact, I've got 3 more screencasts prepared on Swift 3 alone. Swift 3 interacting with Foundation, the new API naming conventions, and finally some stuff that makes working with C APIs worlds apart easier. I hope that this screencast has given you enough knowledge to be able to start converting your Swift code from Swift 2.2 and Swift 2.3 all the way up to Swift 3. We've been assured that going from Swift 3 to Swift 4 will be somewhat easier than this. I shall reserve judgment on that. I'll catch you again soon for another iOS 10 Swift 3 screencast. Love you later. Bye-bye.